responsible for it. Eleemosynary, like a small song. This is my grandmother. She had a stroke.
Could you open the drapes, dear?
She can't really talk. I can hear her, though. At least I think I can.
Oh, that's nice. That's warm.
She's 75 years old. That's not how I see her.
I feel 50 today.
My grandmother believes she could fly using only a pair of homemade wings and the proper classical training. In 1958, she made a 10-minute film, fully professional, of her and her daughter, my mother, trying it out.
Hello, I'm Dorothea Westbrook, and today I'm here to prove that man, or in this case woman, can fly without the aid of any motor of any kind, using only the simple pair of wings you see my daughter, Artemis, wearing here. We have an excellent day for the attempt. A bright golden sky, a brisk wind, and air temperatures in the high 40s. We will try two experiments today. First, the very steep hill, and second, the wooden tower.
Sometimes I think all my problems begin in 1958.
I wish I could be flying myself, but arthritis has made that impossible. Is the camera going? Splendid. Artie,
Mom,
remember all I've taught you.
Spelling the words becomes easy, really. Almost a nuisance. N-U-I-S-A-N-C-E. Nuisance. But what I concentrate on is the meaning of the words, and more than that, feel of them.
The world is filled with an inner conviction, a cord of truth and power which only needs to be unsnarled and drawn taut between its center and our own.
Lots of words have a special feel. Words like prink and zanata, words like dysphemism and autochthonous. Spelling them is nothing compared to just feeling them.
Flap, for God's sake, you call it flapping, you're being filled!
Beautiful words for ugly things. Limiculous. L-I-M-I-C-O-L-O-U-S. Limiculous. Means dwelling in mud. Or this one, Ishurian. Just means hungry. But the way it feels, I used to stop right in the middle of spelling it. E-S-U-R-I. There are words I'd give my life for.
You're not concentrating!
I still have the film my grandmother made.
It's not working!
Keep trying!
I'm not flying!
You will!
Mom was only 15 then. Well, this wasn't the first strange thing Grandma made her do.
Never have a daughter. Never have a child, for that matter, but never have a daughter. She won't like you.
Keep flapping!
My mom's a very intense person. I think it was her upbringing.
Artie, remember, inner conviction.
How are you coming on N, O, and P? Is this a good time to call?
Fine. You don't have to do this if you don't want. Grandma can always help.
No, I've got time, honest. I've got my dictionary right here.
Okay.
Periphery.
We could just talk if you'd rather.
Come on, periphery. Region of air surrounding moving body.
Periphery. P-E-R-I-P-T-E-R-Y. Periphery.
Good. Now, nictotropic.
What?
Nictotropic.
That's a word?
Of course it's a word. I see it in my work all the time.
What's it mean?
Tending to assume at night a position unlike that during the day. Like the leaves or type of plants.
Oh, that's a scientific word. They don't ask those much.
Oh, they don't? I'm sorry.
I can do it.
Can you? You know it?
I can guess. Nictotropic. N-Y-C-T-I-T-R-O-P-I-C. Nictotropic.
That's right. That's amazing. How did you do that? Okay, let's see.
Mom?
Yes?
Let's just talk.
We are talking.
Can't you come over here and help me?
I don't know. You've got Dorothea.
I want you too.
You have me. You do, right here, on the phone. Let's do another word, okay? I mean, I don't know, it could be anything, really. How about orbit?
Orbit? You mean like planets?
Yeah.
You think I can't spell orbit?
Well, why don't you just spell it and we'll move on?
Could you please come over?
No, orbit.
Mom.
Orbit or I'm hanging up.
O-R-B-I-T. Orbit.
Thank you.
There's something about the Westbrook women. We have this need to be extraordinary. It's kind of like having a disease in the family.
Well,
very steep hill seems not to have done the trick. We are moving on, therefore, to the wooden tower.
When I was still in my crib, my grandmother was constantly shoving letters and numbers in front of me. The first thing I ever said was the ancient Greek word for grandma.
My granddaughter is a born genius.
Dorothea raised me from the time I was 2. I could do calculus when I was 9.
I'm not jumping off that tower!
Of course you are, dear.
You said this would be safe!
It is safe! Look at the tower's base. We piled up dry leaves.
Dry leaves?
There will be a slight delay.
My grandmother made me long words. My mom helped too, a little.
Are you my daughter or not?
At 12, I decided to be the greatest speller in history, for life. I didn't realize only kids had spelling bees. I thought there was an adult division.
My daughter is now, about 12 feet above the ground. Let go of the railing, dear.
No!
Don't be stubborn.
Dorothea was one of the notable eccentrics of her time.
Come on in. Come on, Artie. Artie. Why are you so afraid to make history?
No daughter of mine, ever. Daughter of mine.
Mom? Mom? What is it?
Could you please come over?
I can't right now. What's wrong?
I'm a national spelling bee champion.
I know. You can be very proud of you's work.
What'll I do next year?
What do you mean?
There's nothing left to spell. I spelled everything. I spelled Sugma and Withershins and Growful and Fog Dog. I spelled Revenant and Arataxi. I even spelled Tizzis. P-H-T-H-I-S-I-S. Tizzis. Could you please come over?
I don't know.
I even spelled Eleemosynary just like it was cat or dog. I took a beautiful, amazing mechanism and spelled it.
Artie!
Don't take a negative attitude.
Don't take a negative attitude.
Why not? I turned those words into something nugatory and ugso.
Into what?
I made them derendipitous and marmoreal.
Damn it, sweetie, what?
I am. Those are good English words.
Some words are meant to be spelled and not used.
I think spelling bees are the quiddity of habitude.
Well, it appears that we will not be able to complete our experiment today.
Damn right.
What a pity. Hopefully, perhaps tomorrow.
Forget it!
You came so close on the hill.
Never! Are you nuts? Now your bet's on film!
Mom apologized for that later. Grandma never brought it up again. She went right on to other projects. Communication with the dead, spontaneous combustion, astral projection, but she never filmed those.
I'm sorry.
That's all right. I forgive you. I can feel my grandmother in me. My mother, too, a little. Something flies straight through us, straight from Dorothea to me. It's like a gift.
The secret of flight lies in the assurance that we are worthy of flying.
I guess it's a gift.
I have trouble touching my daughter. Well, I have trouble touching most people, but I don't worry about that. It's my daughter that worries me.
Are we only just up for a nap? Are we nervous? We're 3 months old and we're ready to go to school.
Dorothea could touch her all day long.
Do we like school? Do we? Of course we do. Artie, listen, how much she likes about school. She's laughing.
She's laughing because you're tickling her.
Well, I'm sure that's part of it.
Echo, you want to try
this? This is A. Can you say A? That's right, that's A. How about this one? B.
Mom, she's 3 months old. She can't talk.
How do you know?
It's physiologically impossible.
That's just the truth of the body and not the truth of the spirit. Echo, you want to try this? This is...
Her name's not Echo.
Of course it is. I named her.
I named her months ago. I named her Barbara.
That was before I got here. Echo, you want to try this? This is Alpha. Can you say Alpha? That's right, that's Alpha. And Beta. Can you say Beta? That's right, that's
Those
beta.
Baby alphabets she's playing with are the same ones she had over my crib. Pink for Greek, blue for Latin.
How about this one? Lambda, think of a little lion.
Mom, she can't talk.
You certainly sound cross this morning. We should take a good long walk. That's what I do when I'm feeling needlessly aggressive. Go on, maybe you'll meet someone important or famous. I always do.
Who do you mean that's famous?
Last week I met President James Monroe.
You did?
Yes, it really was quite fortunate too. I've been meaning to ask President Monroe about the era of good feelings. That's what they called his presidency. Era of good
20 years ago, the ingredients to raisin bran, what I weighed when I was 12 years old, what my mother said about what I weighed, anything I've ever read or heard or seen or been a part of, it's all up here. Total recall. I suppose some people would be grateful for it, but for me, it's like some sort of memorial with the names of the dead all etched in. No way to forget. I try not to read so much anymore. I don't want to make the memorial any bigger. My daughter, Echo, sometimes thinks that I'm against education. I'm not against education. I'm just against remembering what you learn.
Cathexis. C-A-T-H-E-S-I-S. Cathexis.
Cathexis.
Plein air. P-L-E-I-N hyphen A-I-R. Plein air.
Plein air.
Deodand. D-E-O-D-A-N-D. Deodand.
Deodand. These aren't words. They're fragments of something we used to speak. Greek, Latin, Old German, Old French. They're sediment. They're
detritus. D-E-T-R-I-T-U-S. Detritus.
Echo, I have to hang up now.
Can't we do a few more?
I have to hang up.
Are you all right?
I'm fine.
Really?
Really.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. My mother made sure I had tutors by the age of 4. I remembered everything they ever taught me, of course, which excited them tremendously. Meanwhile, my father was worried that too much of an education would hurt my health through marriage, but my mother told him that a smart girl can hide what she knows, so there's still a chance for happiness.
Well, that's true in a way.
I'm telling you this. When I was 18, I got pregnant.
It was an accident.
Mother! In my 14 years of tutoring, no one, including my mother, ever taught me the facts of life. I knew the entire succession of the Midianite kings, but I knew nothing about the men who cut our lawn. Until I went out with one.
You can't be pregnant! You can't! You're 18!
Mother, I am.
You're about to go to college!
I can't help that.
Of course you can! Your college career!
What college career? I'm going to be a mother.
No, no, you don't have to. You don't have to be. Think about it.
Of course I have to.
No, you don't. You could do something else.
What, you mean like give it up for adoption?
No, that would mean your father finding out. If he knew about this, he'd have you married to someone in 5 minutes. And no college either. You have to do something else.
That's illegal!
In this day, but if
no!
You go already.
I won't do it.
Why not?
It's a life.
It's that life or yours.
How could you say that?
Think about it. If you keep it, none of our plans, none of your potential. Do you see? You'll spend the next 20 years of your life trying to catch up with yourself. You won't be you anymore. You'll just be something a child needs.
What's wrong with that?
You could be more something else.
I don't want to be anything else.
You are. We can't help what God made us. I mean, if you hadn't been born the way you are, I could have waggled letters over your crib forever and nothing would have come of it. You keep it, your father will think, fine, she's just a woman. Like I said all along, I'll find her husband, and he will too. When a soldier in battle suddenly has to kill someone, we say that's all right, that's okay. It's his life or someone else's, and that's the choice, no matter how regrettable. And you have that choice too, and you have to choose now.
I waited a little while. Finally crossed state line, and I ran away right after that, across 3 state lines. I lied about my age and got a job teaching at a private school. I think they were surprised by my interview. They asked what I taught, and I said, what have you got? Ancient history and chemistry. I said I could do both, and I did. I taught kids who were my age. They called me Miss. I spent my free time being delighted to not be around my mother and wondering how she was.
I was fine. That's how I was. I was speaking daily with Mr. Norman Sweet of the Sweet Detective Agency. He was making excellent progress.
One afternoon, I came home from teaching to find my mother sitting in my room.
It's small, isn't it?
No, it's large.
I like the view. You can see a steel plant. It's
better at the other window.
Where would you like to eat this afternoon? Where do you normally eat? Remember, the meal's back home. teacher challenging.
It's a nice school.
A minnow's a nice fish.
You don't have to like it, okay? I don't care if you like it.
It doesn't matter whether I like it or not. You're coming home. Guess what I bought the other day? Yes, it's for you.
Marker.
This is a book.
I can see that.
An 1857 edition of Ovid's Metamorphosis, published in Rome. It's in excellent shape.
It's beautiful.
It was expensive enough, but then I know how much you love Ovid with all those girls of his running away from the gods, turning into cows and constellations and things.
Thank you.
Don't mention it. You have the right to an intellectual life. I wonder if these girls are glad, turning into trees and reeds and whatever. There's something so stationary about a tree. Oh well, too late for them.
I ran away again on my way home. I crawled out the bathroom window of Max Hygienic Cafe. With the book. This time I made sure to move very far away and stay gone for a very long time.
People wonder about me. I realize that. They don't say anything, of course, because of the money. My husband lived very comfortably. He didn't really know what to make of me except a wife. He owned most of the estate by the time he died. Not long after Artie ran away for the second time, he died. Cerebral hemorrhage, very sudden. I'm told he didn't feel it much. I know I didn't. That worried me for a time, not feeling anything about the death of my husband. But then I asked a few of my women friends whose husbands had died, and they said the same thing. So I decided it was common enough and I should not worry.
Euphrasy. E-U-P-H-R-A-S-Y. Euphrasy. A type of plant, also known as eyebright. Bijouterie. B-I-J-O-U-T-E-R-I-E. Bijouterie. A jewel collection. Words are my collection. They're like jewels no one takes out of the case.
Rataplan. R-A-T-A-P-L-A-N.
Rataplan. The sound or beating of a drum. My grandmother loved helping me with words.
You spelled them wonderfully.
I've lived with my grandmother almost all my life. She raised me.
Life is a swift descent, followed by an endless, dreamy, downward nutation.
That means a nodding off.
One can only hope one has risen high enough so that the sights on the way down will be worth the looking.
This is what I imagine she thinks.
I found out how to talk to stones!
You have, haven't you?
She's pretty, isn't she? I'm not blind to good looks, you know, beauty and intelligence. I thought I was a very lucky mother. She's dreaming. I'm in her dream. Do you want to know what I'm like in her dream? It's not her fault. It's not mine either. It wasn't my mother's fault, I suppose. We all try to be just right, just what the next one needs, but we never come close. I was an only child. After me, my mother couldn't have any more. As for my father, well, the only sentence of genuine interest he ever uttered about me was, "Is it a boy?" I became my mother's daughter by default. It gave me such a feeling of worthlessness. It was like an asthma of the soul. I could never take a deep breath of who I was.
For years, I've had the same dream.
Mother didn't say anything. Father only glowered.
I dreamt my mother had found out where I'd moved.
Girls really weren't worth much then.
That I'd find her in my room, like the first time.
Mother told me not to think about it.
I dreamt she burnt my books, that somehow there was this little self-contained fire.
But thinking was the only thing I felt confident doing.
She burnt my pillows, my chairs, just tossed them in.
I read every book I could find.
My curtains, my papers, my clothes.
I read for escape.
Stop throwing things! Stop it! They're mine!
I felt guilty. In those days, a girl did.
And then she would ask me to get in the fire.
But I couldn't stop myself. I felt like an addict.
Get out of my room! Get out!
Can you imagine it? Feeling guilty for learning?
And then she would disappear. Just disappear. And I would be alone again. And everything would be like it was. Only this time, I'd be awake.
The
The day I graduated high school, my father smiled at me and said he had a wonderful surprise, which turned out to be an arranged marriage between me and John Westbrook. John was, I admit, a sort of boyfriend who I thought of marrying perhaps in 4 years. But what about college, I asked my father. He said John is going directly into his father's business. No, no, what about college for me, I asked. He just laughed. He just laughed at the idea that I might prefer college to marriage. He laughed and laughed.
I think you can get stuck on pleasure, don't you? You can get so involved with something you like that you don't hold on to the next thing. Something you might like even more.
My father, and John too, made vague promises that I could go to college sometime only if I'd get married now. On June 2nd, I graduated high school. 2 weeks later, I was married, and 3 weeks later, I was pregnant. John and I had 3 boys and a baby girl. I liked the girl.
For example, I love my grandmother, but since her stroke.
Once I had my last child, I asked John if I could go to college. He said no. I asked him about his promises. He said that's what vague promises were for.
Now there's only Mom, and face-to-face with Mom, it's harder.
Then I met a very strange person.
So I come here and talk to Dorothea, even though she can't hear me.
A very strange person indeed.
I move her arms, do words, and pretend like she's still here.
He was a guest at a summer party. This was in the 40s. Normally, our guests were financial types, but he was a friend of a friend, and he was a spiritualist. I'd always thought such people were weird funereal sorts, but this was the happiest man I'd ever met. He talked for a long time about his investigations into the supernatural. He didn't make these eccentric journeys for any dark, compelling reasons. He simply enjoyed an entirely different world within our reach. I asked him that didn't seem like escapism. He said he couldn't think of a better world to escape from. Look around you, he said. Don't you just itch to escape? But what would my husband think, I wondered. And as though this man was reading my thoughts, said, the best thing about it is, no one holds an eccentric responsible. And suddenly, a great breath of happiness went down into my lungs. Eccentricity, I thought. What a relief! And from that day on, I never listened to a thing my husband said, or anyone else.
My mother chose to be eccentric by choosing to be aloof for it, she said.
Eccentricity solves so many problems. I can stay a wife and a mother and still converse with the souls of animals.
My grandmother's girlhood diary is amazing. She knew everything and loved so many people. When she married, it just stopped. Like she died or something.
Eccentricity saved my life. It became my life. Thank God for it, for all the good and the harm that he has caused.
She can't hear you.
Maybe she can.
I don't think so.
She talks sometimes.
She does not.
Kind of talking.
She grunts like an animal. Why do you keep coming here?
She's my grandmother.
Is she? Does she recognize you?
She doesn't recognize me.
So then what kind of grandmother is she? What kind of mother
she
is
she?
She's
yours and she's mine, so just stop talking.
There is a God who kills, aren't we?
There is, so shut up! You didn't have to come here.
I wanted to see what you two did together.
We just sit here. I open the drapes, I close the drapes.
The nurses will hear you.
The nurses hear me all the time.
You yell while I'm here?
I used to. You tend to quiet down in this place after a while.
It's a very good hospital. They do a much better job than we could. I don't know why you keep coming here.
To see my mom.
Be home in time for dinner.
I will. My mother left me when I was very young. For a while, I wasn't sure if she'd left or just suddenly got a lot older. Or I wondered if there'd ever been a mother at all. Maybe it had always been my grandmother, and I was just confused. I really thought that. I used to ask Dorothea where my mother was, and she'd always say,
she just stepped out.
She what?
She just stepped out, dear.
When's she going to step back in? Grandma? Grandma? Later, when I was old enough, she told me that Mom had gone into research, whatever that is.
Research is a place where you can study for the rest of your life.
Once, she called on the phone. Hello?
Oh, hello. Is Dorothea there?
Who's this?
Just let me speak with your mother.
No.
Who called, dear?
No one.
I heard a phone ring.
It was no one. It was a dead person.
A dead person?
Nearly.
one suitcase that I used to hit with a hammer to show how rugged it was. I used to hit the crap out of that suitcase, but it never broke. The hammer broke. A few years later, I called again.
Mom?
Yes?
I'm still all right.
That's nice, dear.
I'm going to have a baby.
Is this your way of telling me you're married?
Yes. His name is Richard. He's a professor in biochemistry. I'm assisting.
I should say you are. How long have you been married?
A few months.
Oh.
I've gone back to school.
Oh, that's lovely. What did you graduate in?
Biochem.
Oh, that's lovely. Will you do research then?
Yes.
That's great. Interesting research, I hope.
Oh, yes, of course.
That's great. When's the baby due?
6 months.
Oh, I'll come and stay with you.
Oh, but you don't have to do that.
Well, you're going to need your mother if you're going to have a baby. What state?
California.
Out there, huh? Well, I'll have to make some arrangements.
Mom, don't come. I don't want you to.
Nonsense. I'll be there in a week.
Mom.
What?
Don't you want to know what city I'm in?
No, I like the challenge.
A week later, there she was.
Hi!
She bought a house on our block and came over every night. My husband actually liked her.
Richard had taste.
He had more than that. When I was with my husband, it was like I had no memory at all of what I'd been like, of where I'd come from, what I was afraid of. We loved each other. We worked together. Each day was independent from the rest. Like, it had been a whole life in itself. It was experienced, and then it was put away. Simply put away. And every night was quiet, lovely step into another life. When my mother arrived, my memory came back forever.
I saw King Solomon on the street yesterday, but he couldn't stop.
Richard couldn't understand why I couldn't function around her, but I couldn't. She'd come over with a theory about making toads fly.
Don't you worry, dear. I'll be down the street when you need me.
When I had my baby, my mother drove me to the hospital. My husband was at work.
A girl.
Mom!
Oh, she'll fly. I can feel it.
Exactly 1 month after Echo was born, my husband died in a car accident. As Dorothea put it,
one death, one life. The world is always working like that.
When my father died, Mom didn't talk for days. That's what Grandma said, at least. Not even ask for food or anything.
But, as Dorothea put it,
the dead are the dead and the living are the living.
That's not what you always say.
It's what I say at the moment. Now, how are we going to raise this child?
We?
Well, you're a grief. You have a career to think of.
I know I'm a grief.
You see, I'll get my things and move in.
Grandma always sang lullabies to me. She sang them to my mother, too. I never heard my mother sing a word.
Like him?
I do.
Grandma never threw anything away, not even stuff she was sorry for.
I wish they had worked. I wish Artie would have flown. It's hard for Grandma, dedicating her life to concepts that are difficult to prove. When I was a year old, we moved back east, back into Grandma's house. We didn't fly, we drove, all the way across the country. I don't really remember that.
I do. I wanted Echo to see a few things. We made all sorts of educational stops. A secret Indian burial ground, a convention of faith healers in Laramie, Wyoming, Edgar Casey's birthplace, Edgar Casey's grave, Edgar Casey's wife's grave.
A voodoo cult in Louisiana, a UFO landing strip, and the home of a man who'd been to the moon and back in 1956. Our trip across the country took 5 weeks.
Echo saw things that took me years to see.
Echo saw things that weren't there.
It must have been a nice trip. When we got back to Grandma's house, they put me in Mom's old room, though I wasn't aware of it at the time.
She's bright, isn't she?
You call chewing on wings bright?
She already speaks Greek a little.
She doesn't know what she's saying.
She does. Other people don't, but she does. Do you like your Greek these days?
Sure.
I know it's only teaching, but you'll get back to research someday. That's the best.
best thing about the East. There's always a college right down the street.
I have a job option.
Oh, in research?
Yes.
Echo, stop chewing on those.
Yes, I do.
Oh, where is it?
Europe.
Oh, for how long?
No limit.
Permanently?
If I want. Isn't that good news?
Well, are you planning to take Echo with you? She'll grow up speaking a foreign language.
If she already does.
Yeah, the Greek word for grandma. She likes me. She's used to having me around. Sometimes more than you,
I sometimes think. What does that mean?
Oh, nothing. I'm just observing. Echo.
Echo.
Yeah. Nothing. I'm just observing. So, are you sure you have to take this position?
It's the next logical step.
Oh, what country is it in?
Mom, I don't want you to come visit.
Well, I have to come visit. I have to see Echo for one.
You can see her. Every day. Here. I want you to keep her.
Keep her? For how long?
For good. Echo.
Yanyamu.
I want you to keep her for good.
Dorothea and I never talked about Artie much, but sometimes she'd bring out the photographs. And we'd have to.
Echo! Pictures! I found a whole new album with your mother in it.
Okay.
All right. So, here's one. Me and Artie used to go get hypnotized with Miss LaRoe. Here's a picture of Artie hypnotized. It'd be fun to do that with you, but I told your mother we would not.
Why not?
Ooh, here's a shot I like. It's Artie and I on a field trip. I took her to one of those vortexes. You know those houses where the balls roll up instead of down?
No.
Well, they have them. And I took her to see one, and the little ball rolled uphill just like it's supposed to. I personally found a lot of strength in that. Your mother didn't like it much at all. Your mother really didn't enjoy seeing the rules of the world being broken. I knew they weren't being broken. There were just more rules than she thought there were.
How many rules are there?
In the whole world?
Yeah.
How many do you want? Because that's how many there'll be.
I still remember everything, but in particular, I still remember being woken up by my mother when I was 7. The two of us snuck out in the middle of the night. It was late spring. The air was warm. She looked so excited, and she pulled out
a pair of scissors,
and she cut off a piece of my hair.
A lock of your hair.
A lock of my hair. And she said, I will take this lock of hair, cut off in secret at the full moon, and I'll save it as long as you're my daughter.
Whether we love each other or not, whether you remember me or forget me, whether I help you or harm you, I will always have it till the day I die.
And then we went back to home and went to sleep. I tried asking her where she put it the next day, but she wouldn't tell me.
It's a secret, even from you.
I just wanted to know where it was, but no matter how much I begged, she wouldn't tell me.
It's a terrible desire to want to know everything.
So one day, when she was gone, I looked. For 5 hours, I looked through every drawer, under every piece of furniture, under the rugs and the pillows, through her whole jewelry collection, in the bottoms of the drawers, in the backs of the drawers, in the backs of the furniture, under behind pictures and mirrors.
It's a terrible desire to want to know everything.
I stripped the sheets off her bed. I checked under her mattress. I felt in all of her shoes. I looked behind the toilet. I looked through every book and every magazine, and it wasn't anywhere. I mean, it wasn't anywhere in the whole damn house.
It's a terrible desire.
And when my mother came home, she didn't have to ask what I was doing. She found me sitting in a pile of her things. She just immediately walked over to her dresser, pulled out a small screwdriver, walked over to the light fixture, and unscrewed the plastic safety plate, and took out my lock of hair.
Here,
she said.
I don't want it anymore. You may keep it yourself.
I was 7 years old. I called up Dorothea once from Europe when Echo was 7. I have news.
Really? What is it?
I'm coming back. I have a job opportunity in the States, close to you.
Oh, how close?
50 miles.
Wow, that is close. Are you planning to take it?
Yes.
Oh, okay. Well, you know you're always welcome to visit.
I won't come visit.
Call then. You can call us anytime.
All right.
Do you want Echo back or anything like that?
No.
Okay.
My
My new job was a good one. It had a direct link to clinical research. We saved lives. Once I got settled in, I began to call my mother and Echo from time to time. I'd ask Echo about school.
Probability theory is interesting. I'll be able to do more with it when I'm 9.
And I'd ask Dorothea about her life.
Last night, I was assumed bodily into heaven.
Things went on this way for 6 years, and in that whole time, I not once saw Echo.
Once you did?
Well, once, yes. By accident. It was at a book fair. I wasn't going to buy books, more to just hold them, and I was running my hand over the spine of an 18th century edition, wanting more to smell the book than read it, and I saw her. She was far away, but I knew it was her. Dorothea had sent pictures. But pictures don't move. She was beautiful. Just then, she saw me, and I dropped the book and immediately ran. I ran and ran all the way to my car. I don't even remember driving home.
I bought it. Robinson Crusoe, The Life in Strange, Surprising Adventures. I read it 17 times.
I think a woman has the right to be irrational about her children, don't you? Once she has them, she has them. They're hers. She thinks so, her husband thinks so, everybody thinks so. They came from her body, they are her body, and whenever they want love, they can demand it. Forever, from the moment they're born. As long as she can open her eyes, she'll see them. As long as she can hear a sound, it'll be them. The same is true for the one I didn't have. Only that one comes to me in my sleep, asks for her love then. Echo sometimes calls me a bad mother, but if she could see me at night, how good I am, how much I care.
It really is an amazing thing, old age. Look at my skin. It looks like the last layer of tissue paper before you open a gift.
Not long after that, Mom suggested spelling bees. It was probably her way of apologizing for running away from me that one time, but
I'll find one. Just a minute. Metamorphosis. You know that one? No, that's okay. Then how about Celepsis? You know that? No, that's fine. What about Peronymous? Uh-huh. Yeah, no, that's right. Oh, damn. No, nothing. I just dropped the handbook, that's all. Stay on, I'm fine, really.
I think she liked helping me. She spent a lot of time on it.
What do you mean it's not a hard one? A pune is a hard one. Spell it.
A pune. O-P-P-U-G-N. A pune.
Fine.
It was strange suddenly talking to her so much.
How's school?
Fine. They want me to take some college classes.
You're only 13.
Gotta start sometime. How's work?
Good. We're seeing some pretty positive results with the new anticoagulant drug.
You're seeing?
Well, we hear back. Oh, damn.
What?
Oh, nothing. I just dropped the peas, that's all.
I should call back.
Oh, no, they're frozen. Stay on.
What are you working on now?
The potato.
No, I mean at work.
Oh, something with carrot extract. Looks pretty positive. You want another word?
Once, right in the middle of a conversation, I asked her why she left me. No warning. Just asked. All she could say was,
do you want another word?
I decided I was going to get Mom to the National Spelling Bee finals. Oh, she'd said about a million times that she wasn't going, but I didn't care. I knew I was going to be there because no one could beat me, and I knew Dorothea was coming. And I wanted them both to be there when I wanted. I didn't care if they were on opposite sides of the room when it happened. I just wanted them both to see that I was the very best in the whole country. That no matter what they'd done, no matter how they'd done it, they produced in the end someone that was completely all right. Someone with perspective. P-E-R-S-P-E-C-T-I-V-E. Perspective.
I don't know if I can.
Why not?
Things at the lab.
Screw the lab.
Watch your language.
Put little covers on your petri dishes and come.
No, I mean, I don't think I
can. You don't want to.
That's not it.
Then what is it?
Echo.
Mom, if you aren't there and you don't come and congratulate me when I win and say hello to Grandma and kiss her, you can forget about ever calling me again. And I hung up. She came.
They held it in a big, big room with lots and lots of lights.
scared, but only Echo had no fear at all.
Clunch.
I knew my mother was somewhere in the crowd, but...
Glunch. G-L-U-N-C-H. Glunch. Glunch is such an easy word, spelled how it sounds. But you always have that little moment of doubt that maybe you thought the right letter, but you said the... What's he getting? What's his word?
At last it came down to only Echo and a little boy.
Donzel, that's so easy. Why didn't I get it? I know it. Donzel, an unknighted gentleman.
The boy looked very nervous.
Donzel, it's not fair. Why did he get it? Why did he get it? He's guessing. I know he's guessing. He's guessing that dumb shit. He guessed and he got it. I can kill him. Yes, ma'am. I'm ready.
Helena?
Thank God. That's the easiest word there is. I love that word. I deserve it, too. I've had too many hard words, and he's guessed on too many. And I know it. Palinode is a poem in which a poet takes back something he said in another poem. Palinode. P-A-L-I-N-O-D-E. Palinode. This can't go on forever, buddy. I'm going to crack you like an egg.
Echo was different than I thought she'd be. I mean, she was terrific and everything, but she just seemed so desperate.
She was frightening is what she was. More frightening than anyone I could ever remember. Oh, Hitler and Mussolini, of course, but from them, you'd expected it.
What's he getting? What's his word? I don't know his word. What is it? Ovoviviparousness? I know that! It's the quality of being ovoviviparous! Why'd he get it?
I knew Artie might come. I'd wondered what she would think.
Let me win, please. I just want 5 minutes. 5 minutes where all the lights are on me and all the pictures are being taken of me for 5 minutes. I'm the most famous child in America. After that, you can wash me back into the ocean with everybody. I don't care. I'll just be one of the rabble, one of the hoi polloi, one of the clam jamboree, one of the... Excuse me, ma'am. Could you repeat the word, please? Clam jamboree? I don't believe it. She said the exact word I was thinking of. Clam jamboree. C-L-A-M-J-A-M-F-R-Y. Clam jamboree. I know everything in the world!
I didn't know why she was behaving this way, so competitive. I mean, it's good to you, but not too much.
I remembered when Artie first suggested the spell would be, I didn't like the idea. I mean, if you already know how to spell the word, then why beat someone to death with effect? I mean, is that what I raised her for?
Sonia, look at him.
He's so proud he knew a word.
Sonia, everybody knows that! You know you don't. I do. I know how to spell it. I know what it means. I know its derivation. I know its earliest use in literature. I know its...
You missed it. When the little boy missed a word, his little head fell down onto his chest, as though it were on hinges. Echo didn't notice. She was looking at the woman who gave the words. Echo's eyes were wide as an owl. Not the wise old owl. Not like that at all. No, more like the real one. The one that hunts.
Eleemosynary. E-L-E-E-M-O-S-Y-N-A-R-Y.
I made my way down to the front of the room. Echo was being mobbed, but all I could look at was the little boy she'd be. He looked like a dead mouse.
Lights were going off, cameras flashing, and people were shaking Echo's hand, and the boy never moved. And his neck, figuratively at least, was broken.
The kid's mom made him congratulate me. I don't think he ever thought he could lose. He looked almost like an old person. Now he was looking at 60 more years of his life he didn't know what to do with. Mom and Grandma got to the stage at the same time, but by then I'd been pulled over to the side for an interview. I couldn't hear what they were saying.
Oh, hello.
Congratulations.
For what?
For Echo, for her doing so well.
Doing what?
Spelling?
Oh, I see. Artie, I must tell you, I grew very tired of the spelling bee, so I changed it into a ballroom dance. Right now, you're dancing with an admiral.
Mother.
What?
I have to do something.
What?
I have to kiss you.
What?
I have to kiss you so Echo can see. Hi,
like it was.
That's why you want me in. You never have to come into the room I'm in?
I'll be right down the hall.
I don't expect you to like me. I'm going to stay.
You don't know what you're going to do.
I exercised every day of my life right up until the stroke. That was all right, though. I lived a good while already. I was planning to do a lot of research once I was dead. Life was interesting from what I saw of it. I once asked Artie what she thought life was. Do you know what she said? A long apology. No, Artie, not your life, life in general. She hung up, of course. The poor girl could never answer me back, or anyone else for that matter.
I'd always thought Echo would be the one to preoccupy my thoughts in the last year or two of my life, but it wasn't. It was Artie. Imagine, it was Artie.
We were both asleep in chairs when she died. The nurse came in and found us like that. Must have looked like mass suicide. She woke up Artie first and told her.
Thank you.
The next day, Mom and I had our first real fight.
It started over the week.
She wanted to burn them.
I didn't think it was so unreasonable.
I found out she'd been burning things all morning. Anything that was evidence of Dorothea's eccentricity. Like she'd been a witch or something.
I'm not saying she was a witch.
Then what are you saying?
Will you just give me the wings?
I can't believe you burned all those things. You even burned her books!
Oh, for God's sake, they were books and levitation.
They were hers!
They aren't anymore!
Relatives will be coming soon for the funeral.
Just put these things away then. They won't be looking all through the house.
Of course they will. It's her estate. They inherit things too. My brothers are all coming.
Why don't we just put things in the garage? Why don't we put them under something?
They're looking forward to seeing you.
I don't even remember them.
They remember you. Your Uncle Bill is bringing his whole family, his wife and two girls.
Why don't we just put Grandma's things in the garage?
You know, the little girls, they're just a little bit older than you are.
What are we going to do with Grandma's
things? I don't care! I think you'll like your Uncle Bill. He was always my favorite brother. They would like you to go live with them.
What?
They said they would be very pleased if you went to live with them.
Whose idea was that?
Mine. They're a very normal family.
I don't want a normal family.
I'll be bad for you. I've always been bad for you.
You have not.
You could try it just for a few.
You said you were staying.
I was wrong. I thought I could, but...
What's so wrong with me?
Nothing.
Then why do you keep leaving me? Why? Whitney and Beth. I sat between them the whole ride home. It was obvious they had been told to be nice to me. They told me they loved my clothes and wanted to know where I got them. I told them I didn't know. Then it was quiet for a while. Then Beth asked where I bought the wings, but Uncle Bill broke right in and said, "Your mother is very well thought of in her field. You should be proud of her." Then it was quiet again. Then Whitney said, "If you want, you can borrow my clothes." Then we were home.
I moved out of my room and into Dorothea's. The next day, I moved into a guest room. A couple of days later, I moved down to a sleeping porch. That was a little better. I planned on staying there for a week or two, tying things up. But the day before I went back home, I turned around and,
"Hello.
What are you doing here?"
"My things are in the hall. Where do you want me to put them?"
"Where's your Uncle Bill?
I left them."
"Why?"
"I don't know. We were all at one of Whitney and Beth's lacrosse games, and I just left."
I'll go call them.
Tell them I'm staying here."
"You are not staying here. You are not.
That's why you said you love me."
"I said yes and no."
"But that means sometimes you do. And that means if I work at it enough, I can get you to love me more of the time. Most of the time."
"I'm calling your Uncle Bill."
"Uncle Bill hardly remembers you, you know that? I asked him what you were like as a little girl, and he couldn't even say. He remembers Grandma even less. He didn't have one interesting story about her. About Grandma. They don't even have a single picture of her. Not even in their minds. To them, she's just a woman who lived a big, embarrassing life. They all think they saved me just in time. Not just from Grandma. From you, too."
"They didn't see that."
"They don't have to. So I started wondering if they were right. Maybe the smartest thing to do would be to forget both of you completely. After all, what did I forget from the two of you except a good education? You especially. What more were you ever to me except a voice on the phone now and then?" And I looked around my new room where I was staying, and it was nice and blank. The way a thing is before you put any time into it. I thought, I could live a whole new life here. I could invent a whole new me. I could be Barbara if I wanted to, not Echo. I could fit in. I don't mean to become like Whitney and Beth. I'm not that crazy. But I could be like Robinson Crusoe and adapt myself to a strange and harsh environment. I could live in a kind of desert. I could even thrive like you have. I could live without the one thing I wanted. But I kept hearing your voice. That voice on the phone, hiding behind spelling words, making excuses, or so energetic sometimes, so